So let's look at the whole concept of using, again, computing derivatives using cross-correlation. Let's take a simple example here of an image of a monarch butterfly. Here I'm interested now looking for is how can I actually extract from this the two derivatives, both in the x, which is in the columns, and in y. What I can do basically is now I can come up with a kernel and cross-correlate with that to be able to extract my derivative. I could look for derivatives in columns, that is x, or I need to look for derivatives in y. So for doing this computation for the original, for del f, x, y, and x, how about I use this simple kernel like this, where I take the negative value and the positive value, this is what we did in the last slide, and see if we do an inner dot product with each and every aspect of the image. This is what we get as an output. This is exactly what we wanted, right? Because we wanted to be able to kind of look at where there was, as I traversed this way, maximal change in an image, which was referred to, of course, as the derivative in x. Similarly, for del y, change in y, we need to create a filter that has and looks for the derivative change in this direction, which is basically minus 1 and 1 here. Again, we showed the example in the last slide of this, but in this case, of course, we would do this for y. This was for del x. Looking at this process, we will actually now notice the same monarch butterfly starts giving me information as I traverse down this way. So basically what we've done is taken these two kernels and applied them separately to this original image using the cross-correlation method, something we've looked at before. Just in the last image, you may not have been able to see all the details. Clearly, I'm just zooming up the images so you can see the monarch butterfly and the dx and the del dy of this. So in this image, as I traverse in the column, you can see basically, again, gradient changes happen here. And of course, what kind of a bright line, dark line, which basically, again, shows that there was a peak and a trough or changes in the image gradients itself. In x and y, of course, we notice the same phenomenon coming down this way. So here, for example, you can see more details of this part here, but you don't see it here. But of course, coming down in this axis, you see more details here, and you don't see that here. Of course, as we've looked at with gradients, we can want to compute more information out of it. This output was generated basically using a kernel process, where we basically came up with the kernel that I showed you and used that to generate these images.